Hello. Welcome to the Community Matters Show. Today we're going to have a special show, but first of all, I want to wish everyone a happy Love Day. We are going off a previous show where we used to do Happy Love Day, and today we're going to do it again. We're also having a guest in the studio, and we're going to talk about the community and what matters in the community with our consolidated government councilman, Patrick Pat Lewis, for District 3. He's been in the office now a little over a year, and I think he's very deserving to be here to talk about some of the wonderful things that he have done and his future plan for District 3. Councilman Pat Lewis, welcome to the show.
Well, welcome and thank you. And like you said earlier, Love Day. Happy Love Day to everyone.
Yes.
I'm glad to be here. I'm glad you invited me here to your community hour you have. Appreciate being here, and I appreciate that I'll be able to explain to the constituent and to the public that's listening that my plans for the District 3. As you said earlier, I just became elected in last year, January. I was elected. I started my first day, in fact, was January 4th, 2016. And I'm excited. There was a lot of things that happened last year, and I'm looking forward to my next few years that I'm on the council.
Councilman, tell me this. What made you want to be the councilman for District 3?
Wow, that's a good question. I can start off by saying that I'm from District 3. I was born, raised, educated, and married in District 3. So saying all that, it bring back memories back in the early 60s when I was growing up in District 3. I remember how it was in District 3. And I know it cannot be like that again, but I would like to make sure the people that I represent in District 3 have the quality of life that we deserve and the hope that they want to have. And that's why I decided to run. I said, well, you know, I'm from that area. I know how it was, as I said earlier. And I like everyone in that district to have at least a part of what they used to have. Now, if they wasn't living at that time and being brought up at that time, let them know that District 3 has a lot of good people, really good people, and they deserve a chance, deserve to have what other areas of the consolidated government have. And that's what I want to make sure that we are well represented. As I said, that's not my seat. It's for the people that elected me. That's their seat. I'm their eyes, ears, and I'm their voice.
Well, unlike you, I was born and raised in District 3 also.
Good.
Even though I left and was gone for a while, when I came back, a lot of things were still the same, even though things was changing.
Yeah.
And I could honestly say, since you've been the councilman for District 3, a lot have changed. Some things still need to be changed in the district, you know, and I'm pretty sure everyone I talk to in the district appreciate a lot of things that you're doing to make their quality of life better.
Right.
So, what have you planned for your future in your district? You have anything special planned?
Yeah.
But before you get into that, I have to stop you. I want to commend you for having the Martin Luther King Memorial Expressway sign put on the right side of the street.
Oh, I appreciate that. And that way you can see both coming from both directions.
Both directions.
The ones that were there before is still there. We just added some more. So that way, whatever direction you're coming from and whichever direction you look, when you see a sign, you'll see Martin Luther King Memorial Parkway on both sides. You can look on your left side, you can look on your right side, and you will see it. And I'm so happy it was done before the Heritage Parade. So that way, unfortunately, the weather was not cooperating with us. I wish it was like it had been last year. I can recall when it was nice and sunny, sure. The weather was good, more people would be able to see. But you know, it's one of those things. I'm just so excited it was done at that time. And there's a lot more things that'll be coming, in you know, around that area as well.
Well, I know you have had a lot of blatant property houses removed that was eyesore to the community. I also know that you have went into what you could say empty lots, vacant lots, and you have done a wonderful job making sure that things was happening. I've seen streets been resurfaced. You know, so now this is what I have seen that the community is telling me about that is being done. Now I'm going to turn it back over to you and let you, you know, finish, because you're on the inside. I'm on the outside looking in.
Yeah, that was one of the things. I couldn't wait till we start the budget process, which was in back in September around that particular time. And I just wanted to make sure that the budget was more or less how I understood a budget to be. I'm familiar with budgets and what have you, putting it together. And I was well satisfied and pleased with it. It's just some things that I have to put in place. I was one thing I was able to do when I was campaigning that I wanted to make sure that Walker Road and Abear Road, that the drain would be taken care of. So I was able to put $1 million in there to make sure that that comes to a reality, which it will be coming hopefully sometime toward the end of 2017, beginning of 2018. That will happen. The money is there, is in the budget, over $1 million to make sure that that Walker Road and Abear Road, the drainage problem, will be taken care of. There's some other things that we put into the budget that will be happening. In fact, you hear the mayor president talking about the University Avenue. We're gonna start off with around the full corner, around the underpass. That will be happening soon. More information will be let out. But again, the president, Mayor President Joe Robidoux, he's gonna have a annual report that he'll be giving out in the end of this month, somewhere I think the 29th or the 30th of March. And I don't want to say too much until he give his presentation. Mm-hmm. You know, I respect him that much. He's doing a fantastic job as well. And everyone on the council, we all working together, and we all want to make sure that, you know, District 3 gets what they need and their district get as well, get what they are concerned about and their needs are. Everyone has needs, but District 3 has a lot of needs, and I represent, and everyone will tell you on the council, I'm very bias when it comes to three. Three comes first, no matter what. You know, I may not get it, but they know it's coming, you know, so they know I fight for three. You know, it's a big, large district. It's very unique. You know, I have the downtown area, I have the bars, I have, I think, more churches than any other district. I have the sheriff, the police, the courthouse, USUL, mm-hmm. Girard Park. You know, I have it all, plus the regular working people, you know. That's very unique. The other district have maybe just the constituents, but I have the constituents and businesses, you know, and I'm glad to represent them. I really, truly am.
You know what? I could honestly say I have seen you in your district riding around, and if I stop you, I ask you, what are you doing in the district, man? I ain't never seen nobody here before. He said, well, I got to make sure. You always told me I got to make sure things are being done, right, and what I see need to be done and what the constituents call me on need to be done. I have to make sure that I could get it done. And yep, that's highly appreciated.
Yeah.
Also, I noticed on university, they used to have a barricade turning off a university, going into Truman, or into a business at that intersection. I'm seeing that the barricades are being moved.
Yeah, when I was first elected, a constituent called me and he had some concerns about the barricade. So, like you just said, you see Marana, I went and check it out and I look at it. And I remember I've been seeing it, but I didn't know it had played a big impact like it did. So one of the first projects I worked on, asked, you know, some constituent complained, their complaints, so I reached out to the state, to Sean Wilson, and you know, other people that works for the state that has an influence, and I asked them to come by and look at what was going on so we can remove those barricades. I mean, that's such an ugly and another eyesore. I mean, right on university, where that's a, I campaign that university is the gateway through Lafayette, and I want to make sure that it's clean, is very friendly, and inviting. So I was able to get them to remove the barricades, and what they're going to do is remove the barricade and put it some type. In other words, still won't be a cross through, but what's going to happen if you're traveling from interstate going south? About once you pass the racetrack, about the next block over, they'll have what they call a J-turn. So that way they'll add more or less like an extra lane when they make that J-turn, passing by Who Dat Kitchen and June Andrews. They'll have about maybe an extra 12, 20 foot, so that way people can turn that's coming from the racetrack or the Cracker Barrel. Because if you're coming from the racetrack or Cracker Barrel, you want to get to Church's Fried Chicken, or you want to go back on Interstate 10, how you get there? And there's no sign that tell you how to get there. So I look at that, and I call these guys over, and we say, we need to do something about that. So they were very excited to understand that, hey, the councilman is really want to make that happen. And so they work with me, and it's being done.
Good.
A little later, I wish it would have happened back in, last year, but I was told it should have happened in around September, October, but the government moved a little slow.
Well, the thing of it is, the job is getting done, and you're making sure that the job is done. Another thing I want to commend you on, these card that says Lafayette Consolidated, Lafayette City Parish Government, Patrick Pat Lewis, District 3. I want to commend you on these cards, man, because this is the first time I have went through a councilman with the frequent use number on the back of his card. Mm-hmm. You know, every time I wanted to call for anything or see about anything, I always had to look in the phone book or try to find somebody to do something different. You know, and that's our phone ringing, but that's okay.
I'll get it.
we'll get it later.
Yeah,
you know, and it says frequent use number, and when you gave me this card, I looked at it and I said, wow, you know, this man do have some concern about his district, because not only they could call you, but they could also call these frequent use number.
Right.
You know?
Yeah, sometimes, not that I may not be available, but, you know, like right now, we're doing this with show right here, and someone can be calling, and, you know, it's an emergency, could be anything, a dead rodent on the street, or animals that's loose, or street light is out, or anything, electricity is out, or there's busted pipe somewhere, and they may want to call me because I represent District 3, but that way they have a number in the back who they can call, or they may have a problem with their utility that was cut off by some unknown reason that we don't know. It could be a mistake or anything. So they can call before, in other words, instead of calling me or my office, we might not answer the phone, which we always try to answer on the third ring, but in case we don't answer the phone, there's these numbers in the back that they can call. When I hand out my cards, I give them that, and then I tell them a lot of time, look in the back. You might have a pothole, might have vacant property, or that the grass is not being cut. And sometimes people don't want to talk to me or the someone that works in the office. They prefer calling themselves. They like to handle their own business. So I just say, just in case they're one of those that want to handle their own business or they cannot contact us, they can also contact it themselves. So I like the idea that, but you know, about on the card, the back of it.
Well, before I got this card, I used to call your secretary,
right?
And that's Joseph.
Oh, the clerk. Yeah, the clerk. Right.
That's the clerk.
He's the assistant clerk.
That's his name, Joseph.
Joseph. Yeah. Very nice guy.
Every time I called him, he's always handled things professionally.
Right.
After I talked to him, he asked me my address. Mm-hmm. He sent me a copy of what I requested through your office. And I think that's a very professional young man.
Well, he is very, very good. I mean, you know, I hear nothing but good things about him. Whenever someone calls, I mean, when I called him back, he did first thing he tell me, I said, hey, before we start our conversation, I want you to tell Joe how I really enjoy talking with him. In fact, I can't say more enough about Joe, but all the staff are good. You can call any one of them. They are good staff people. That's one thing I'm glad. When I took office, I didn't know these people were there for us. You know, I really did not know that. I thought that I was on my own. I thought I had to take care of everything. But I tell you what, they there for me. You know how you say in the street or whatever, they have your back. They have my back.
Right.
They have all the councilmen back.
Well, that's good. They really do.
They're some good workers. You know.
That's good. So, in your future, what is a big project for you that's coming up?
Well, there's two for sure, but there might be more, but I'm going to just elaborate on two of them. There's a big project that should be coming up somewhere in 2018. That's the North San Antoine project. If you're familiar with North San Antoine, you're coming from El Cito's, the club off of Willow Street, and you pass in front of El Cito's. That's San Antoine, North San Antoine right there, and you continue on going to Interstate 10. Now, that road, it curves, and it goes all the way till it gets to Pointe de Mouton. But it's gonna, instead of curving, it's gonna go right on Interstate 10 and then continue going straight till it gets to Pointe de Mouton. So it'll take a few years to complete, but that's in the workings right now. That's one project. And another project that's dear to me, I'd like them to see where, again, the university, but also in the future, because university is coming now, but the future would be widen up Willow Street. Once you get to university, Willow Street becomes a two-lane all the way to Ambassador. I like to see it becomes a four-lane. And that's one another project I like to see us put a frontage road on the side of Interstate 10 somewhere along there. You know, if you look at all the development that's happening in Cancro, happening in Scott, happening in, you know, all these other little areas, is always along a frontage road. So District 3 need a frontage road so we can be like all the other little municipalities like Cancro and Scott and Broussard and what have you. So we need that frontage road, even if it's from Louisiana Avenue all the way to Scott.
Right.
You know? And
join it and Scott.
Right. So that way we can have a lot of development. Of course, I would like to see some commerce, some business come into the District 3. When you look at it, around where I'm talking about these furnished roads, there's a lot of people that live in the Truman area. They want to work. They might be working, but they like to have jobs right near their home where they wouldn't need transportation to go all the way on the south side, all the way to Acadiana Mall or wherever the development is. Develop right there in the neighborhood. You know, they won't need that transportation. They can walk, they can ride bus, or they can ride bicycle. You know, Lafayette is trying to be bicycle friendly.
So
we can do that. We can do that there if we develop around Interstate 10, around District 3. You know, because I want to make sure that District 3 at University is the gateway into Lafayette.
Well, I'm pretty sure the councilman that's on the council seat right now would be happy to work with you on that.
Oh, yes, yes.
For the first time, we have two ladies on the council. They seem like they wants to get things done. They're not biased on just their district.
Right.
The men also is not biased that they just want to get things done in their district. I think all y'all working together pretty much.
Yes, we are. We all have a good relationship. The two ladies bring a lot of, you know, variety. You know, again, they are unique in their own ways. They can tell us things that we may not, you know, just like in your home, the lady always know things that you may not know.
No.
And I tell you what, all nine of us have a really good relationship. You know, we all try to work together, make sure if I want something, they try to work with me to get it. If they want something, we try to, it's not who wants more than the other.
No.
Right now, we all just want to work together, make sure we all get what we want. Remember, we all represent a district. So we want to make sure that every district gets what they want. And I mean, I can't commend them more than that. I mean, I'm so happy that, and excited. I mean, this is a job that I love to go to when we have our meetings. I enjoy it. I enjoy my council meeting when I have with my fellow council women and men, the staff, Joel Robidoux's staff. And I mean, I can't say nothing bad about them. And I had many, many jobs, and you know, I'm just excited because it's a good relationship that we all have.
Well, you know, at one time, one of my pet peeves was the four corner and the deplorable condition that it was in.
Yeah.
Well, they managed to get that done.
Yeah.
Now,
well,
my next pet peeve is that underpass.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and I'm hearing that you have big concern about the underpass.
Yeah. You know, again, as I said earlier, that we will be starting with the underpass first. That's part of the university. And I do know a lot of people are concerned with the Les P. Motel. We want to do something with it. You know, I believe, and the mayor also believe, that if we can have some entrepreneurs come out there, because it's some prime property, come out there and purchase the Les P. Motel, the property, and do some investment. You know, because once that opened up, you'll be surprised how all that area, the Four Corner area, all Cameron Street. I remember growing up, that was the place to be. Four Corners, you had Toby's restaurant, Jacob's restaurant, Pat Theaters. I mean, service station around there. I mean, everyone, all walks of life, all races was coming there just because, you know, if you look at it, the Four Corners, if you want to go to Lake Charles or Texas, and you need a ride, somebody going that way. You want to go to Morgan City and New Iberia, someone going that way. You want to go up north towards Alexander and Shreveport, someone going that way.
Yes,
you know,
sir.
It's all, so you just get there, get to one of those little spots on Four Corner, you can easily get a ride.
Well,
you know, that's how it was back then.
The interstate took a lot of that away.
Yeah, they sure did.
When they start putting the interstate through, a lot of inner city gas stations start closing down. A lot of little mom and pop stores start closing down, especially when we start getting these big corporate department stores into the city.
Right.
A lot of things shut down, but.
Well, we can do something there, like someone might be interested in putting a little small restaurant, some type of building where they can rent out to some attorneys, some engineers, some professional people. I've been reaching out to different people, the businesses, the schools, and UL. And I've been reaching out to a lot of people to see who wants to do a joint partnership with a organization. And you know, everything is getting closer and closer. You know, so something going to happen real soon. I believe that once we fix that underpass and get it looking real nice, that way the people start taking a second look and say, you know what, this really is a nice spot. So open up a business or do some type of entrepreneur there, and it's gonna happen. I'm sure it's gonna happen sooner than later.
You know, right.
Sooner than later.
Mm-hmm. Well, community development. Mm-hmm. You have a relationship with community development.
Sure.
At one time, we had a lot of things going on within the inner city community, and something happened down the road, like I was we have talked about that other than on the show, you know, that it need to come back. It need to come back to make sure that a lot of things in the community is gonna happen again. Why it left, I got my own theory about it, you know, but I think we could get it back because of the concern that you have for your district.
Right.
You know, you got a big district, man.
Oh, man, I have a district that, I tell you what, is real huge. And getting back to what you are saying about it left the, you know, back in some, in the times, I'm talking about years ago, I believe what happened is that, you know, it was a lot of cutback in funds and what have you. And then all of a sudden, you know, people just forgot. I mean, it's just a strange thing. And I can't answer what had happened, but I know there's a lot of areas that all of a sudden thing, you know, you can look in at a D chart of the states, or you can go right there in Lake Charles. Things had been dormant, then all of a sudden things picking up again. You go to Lake Charles right now, it's flourishing, you know. So a lot of things happened back then in the past where everyone wanted to cut back. There, you know, you had, they were just cutting back. The federal government wasn't giving out as much funds. And then when they would get funds, what happened? I mean, let's be honest. A lot of things went on the other side of town. I mean, you know, let's be honest about it. And everything, you know, the came up the plan was to develop back there, you know, and that's what happened, to develop that back then. But people want to come back on the north side. You know, there's better property, a better everything is just good on this side of town. But there was a plan to develop the other side of town, and that's where it went. The leaders let it happen. I mean, what I'm saying, I'm not talking about District 3 leaders. I'm just talking about people in general just want to develop the other side of town. And I don't have anything against it, but I'm just saying what my beliefs were. And now I want to make sure that things come back to District 3.
Well, my thing was with HUD.
Yeah.
You know, and a lot of people think HUD is housing development, housing project, putting low-income families in apartment living or housing development.
Right.
And HUD is bigger than that.
Well, like you understand that, I'm glad you bring that up because you were asking one of my projects. That's another project right there when you're talking about HUD and community development. Another thing, something else that's dear to me is that around the Willow Street, and let's put it this way, between Gilman Road, I'm sure everybody knows where Gilman Road is. Mm-hmm. Gilman Road going all the way up to Martin Luther King. Not mm-hmm. Martin Luther King Memorial. I'm talking about Martin Luther King
Street.
Street, right, road. That's all considered a flood zone. And I'm trying to work something out that we can do away with it, do something. Because what's bringing that up is that when you're talking about HUD, the people live there. They can't get their home rehab through the HUD because they don't rehab homes that's in a flood zone. And let's look at the area. A lot of these homes need to be rehabbed. And they cannot rehab their home because it's in a flood zone. So we need to get rid of that. And I grew up there. I grew up in Washington Heights. I never remember a flood there.
It never did. Don't.
We just had that, what they call 1,000 flood. Mm-hmm. It never flooded at all. If anyone home flood there, I need to know about it.
We had water in the yards, but not flooding.
Right.
You know, like we didn't have no 3 and 4 feet of water in our home.
Right. And no one called me and told me water went in their home. Now I'm talking about in District 3. I'm not talking about in the one. Mm-hmm. I'm talking about that side of District 3.
Three.
Now maybe someone on the other side of District 3. Remember, District 3 is from Interstate 10. Well, no, from more or less Glory Switch all the way to Fatima. That's how long District 3 is from north to south.
Right.
That's how it is. And then, you know, it's a wide, long district. So, but around that area I'm talking about, where it's considered a flood zone, there's no one that lives in that flood zone that say their house was flooded.
That's like gerrymandering. You know, what they're saying that our area is in a flood zone.
Right.
And like gerrymandering the district to where they start chopping on boats.
Right.
You know, and I notice a lot of time the annex property is being into the city of Lafayette for voting purposes.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You know, and sometimes I have a problem with that, but I kind of left that alone.
Right.
I'm worried now on how can we go and get our inner city out of the flood zone area.
And then again, what I'm saying is only that section right there from Gilman Road until Martin Luther King Road. And that's where, and then from, let's say from west to east, we're talking about from University until the Furnace Road by Walmart. That's considered the Wine Alley area. If you're familiar with Wine Alley, Washington Heights, Truman, that's considered a flood zone. And people that live there all their life, 40, 50 years, it never flood. But it's in a flood zone where you can go in some area where they had that flood back there toward Youngville. It's not considered a flood zone, but it flooded.
It flooded.
And then somebody, like you know, for instance, let me bring you back what I see at the opening beginning when I was talking about Walker Road and Abear Road. It flooded there every little small rain it had, but it's not considered a flood zone. No, around that trailer park and all, it's not a flood zone, but it flooded every rain they have, a good rain of a couple of 2-3 inches, it flood, the street flood. People cannot go to work or go from work, go back home. So what I'm saying is that the Truman era where I grew up and watching how it never flooded.
Mm-hmm.
But they consider it a flood. So that leads me to believe that the people in there, they cannot rehab their homes. And people call me. There's grant funds that we can receive from HUD and from community development. That grants, if you have a, for instance, let me give you a good example. A house that we call that we want to have demolished because mm-hmm. It's not, you know, safe and it needs to be broken down for some unfortunate reason. You know, there's grant funds that can make that happen. But they can't get that funds because it's in a flood zone. They can't do that. Or they have a tree that they want to remove. When I say they, I'm talking about my constituent.
Mm-hmm.
It cannot be removed because they're in a flood zone. Now, I don't think that's fair. And not that I don't think. I know it's not right. So I'm doing everything I can to reach out to the right people to come back out here. And I know the federal government
mm-hmm.
to make sure that they can take that off their flood zone map.
Yeah.
And I think, if I'm not mistaken, I think that was put in 1986, somewhere around. Don't quote me, but it's somewhere, because I know my parents have a house way back in the 60s, and people were building back there. They didn't need flood insurance because it
mm-hmm.
wasn't flooding.
Right.
So I don't know why and what happened that it became to be a flood zone. And again, I'm glad you refreshed my mind about that because that's something that I need to really, not necessarily me, but that's something that needs to be done. They need to be removed from the flood maps, period. Because
right.
it's not in the flood zone.
Well,
and then you have, excuse me, you have what they call a floodway, which is even worse. That's around where the that car dealership is just removed from University
mm-hmm.
and Willow. And they have some property that now they want to sell because it was supposed to be developed there.
Mm-hmm.
But these people don't want to come and invest their money because a floodway, it's hard to build something there. So when they find it's a floodway, they decide to relocate. And that's a problem. That goes out infrastructure right there.
From what I'm looking at and know and what I know about the community, we have a lot of nice waterway coolers. I call them waterway.
Yeah,
they call
yeah.
them coolers.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
No, they're nice, cemented in.
Right, right, right.
Seem like the water flow.
It does. It drains.
Yeah. We get more water on University because of the lack of the drainage system, you know, and the drainage system need to be cleaned out. And I noticed in the community, they're going through and they're cleaning drains
yeah.
out, cleaning them more
yeah.
out now
yeah.
than they ever
yeah.
did before.
Well, I try to put them, I'm not saying I don't dictate what they do, what happened,
mm-hmm.
but then I have a little input. And I have a little, every now and then I ask Joseph, we were talking about him now, and then to schedule the sweet sweepers to go out in this subdivision or the drainage people to start doing this drainage,
man,
you know. So I'm having a little, yeah, what's that?
The street sweeper. I ain't never seen a street sweeper in the community
yeah.
like
yeah.
I see it now.
Yeah.
You know?
So what Joseph and I are doing is that we have, every once in a while we send out to Public Works or whoever that department is, to have the, you know, work on the drainage here,
mm-hmm.
work on the, because I mean, I know they can't do everything
mm-hmm.
in one, but if you put them, I'm not, don't get me wrong, I say put them on a schedule, but if you let them know where there are some problems, some concerns, which I know is all over,
mm-hmm.
because I'm sure it never been done in I don't know how long, so, you know, give them a little time here, give them a couple of weeks or months to do a few streets, and then, you know, go do a few more. It's not, I don't want them to, everyone knows District 3 needs a lot of help, you know, for those drains to be clean, but they won't do it in a month or two. It takes a little time. So they'll get to you guys, just they'll get to you sooner than later.
Yeah, well, like I said, man, I'm very pleased with you being a part of District 3. You have really uplifted it in many ways, you know, and I hope that you continue doing that.
That's I retire from one job to do this. You know,
mm-hmm.
I always did love working with people. I worked in the at the school system for 25 years, and my job was always working with people. In fact, my last day of work was January 4, 2016. I was inaugurated to this position January 4, 2016. Same day, left one job, started another job.
Yeah.
So I know, but this here is really more fulfilling. Because when I was at the school board, I dealt in transportation, dealing with the parents and the students and the principals. And then I retired as an auditor dealing with business and again with the school system. Now I'm dealing with the public, you know, and I like helping people. I like working with people. I like talking, as you can tell. That's me, you know. I just like doing things. It would satisfy me the most when someone has a problem. If I can reach and touch them and make things happen, I mean, hey, that's what it's all about, you know. So when people see me or talk about me, you know, I just want them to say, hey, he tried his best. He got it done. Or if it didn't get done, he tried his best. Or something that cannot be done. I won't give up on you. As long as you don't give up on me, I don't give up on you. You know, that's what I like about this job. You know?
Good, you man. Know? And you know, like I said, I'm very pleased with your performance as a council person. And I'm all over.
Yeah, well,
in the district. I'm all over the district, man. Different stores, people that knows you, people that knows what happened for you to get where you are today. They speak highly of you and saying the good things that you're doing. You know, I haven't heard anything negative, you know, and that's a good thing, you know, and through your future as being District 3 councilman, I wish you the best of the best, you know?
Yeah. Well, that's one thing, like you see, you drive around a lot, and that's what I do. I ride around the district that I represent, and a lot of time I get complaints, and or Joseph get the complaints, and he emailed me, and I ride around to see what's going on, or and if it got done, I want to make sure that it was done to my constituent satisfactory. You know, because sometimes things happen and they don't like it, so I want to see what's going on. I mean, yesterday I must have visited about 4 constituents, just drop up, knock on their door. They were surprised that I said, yeah, I mean, that's my job, you know. Mm-hmm. Or sometimes they may call me and if I lose their number for some unknown reason, I go and knock on their door. I might not know their number. I know where they live. I have the address written down and I go to their house. I say, I spoke to you. Oh, man, you can't see. I got to go. In fact, today, after we get through, I have someone I got to call back. They have some concerns about their driveway.
So in other words, you're saying you don't want nobody to tell you it must be election time. That's the only time.
When that time comes, they'll say, oh, no, we see him. I make my rounds. I mean, because it's true. Again, I feel that if you represent someone, you need to be visible.
Right.
You need to be visible. I'm not going to stay at my house or stay at the office or stay somewhere and just wait for a phone call and then call them back. No, I want to see what's going on, because not unless you see, then you really know. A lot of time people call and just talk to me about this and that, but you may not see me, but I go right around. Mostly every complaint I get, I can't count the ones I didn't go. I can count because I knew basically what it was. I happened to know that person would have, but mostly every complaint, I go and check it out.
Good.
Go and check it out because I want to see it myself. And then once I get a note that it was complete, I go back and I make sure it was complete. Because sometimes people don't call me and tell me that it was complete, so I don't know if it's done. So I call them back or I have someone call, did your complaint get taken care of? And if it's no, why? I mean, I want to find out what's going on. So I did have somebody there that it hadn't got complete. But I know whenever someone give me a complaint, I go back because I'm concerned. It needs to be fixed.
Mm-hmm.
I know when I want something done, I don't want to wait. I want it done. You know?
Yes, sir.
I know. Want it done. Then you get a lot of problems with people throwing debris, like using these streets as a dump site. I mean, this is crazy, you know? I mean...
Well, that was another one of my pet peeves for a long time. And look like on Sunday morning, you had more debris in the streets, and when I say debris, gold cup, gold plate. Why some people can't learn how to take their trash to their garbage can at their house instead of throwing it in the street and make your community look bad, making the front of somebody's house look bad. I seen some guys came into the area around the Four Corners, I believe it was, and they picked up a lot of trash and things that was lingered in the street. And one of them said, Lafayette, we have to do better. That's like Houston, we got a problem, you know, and we got a problem with keeping our neighborhoods clean, I feel, you know, because maybe a month ago, you gave Outstanding Citizen Award
to Greg Seymour.
Yeah. And how he keep up the trash and pick up all the trash in his neighborhood and things like this here. Well, I done start doing it little here, little there. Not as hard as he do it, but you know, within the neighbor, next door neighbor and in the front of my house and things like this here, I done start doing it. And
yeah, that was a good thing he does. Yeah, and what he also do is he go and get your trash can in the backyard and bring it to the street. And then in the afternoon when he get off of work, he bring it back in the backyard. Yeah. I mean, he does it is for not for feed, not for anything. He paint posters, he paint fire hydrant, he if someone doing something in the neighborhood, he go and help them out. And I mean, I just couldn't believe this man was doing this. When I was campaigning, someone told me about that. And I say, what? And I talk to some of the neighbors. They say, yeah, that's what you do. And the man works hard. He does roofing.
Yeah.
So before he gets up, before he go to work at 5 o'clock in the morning,
he's out there.
He's out there. And I was talking to one of the neighbors one day, and I just happened to go there, and something came to mind. I asked him, I said, I heard what Greg does. He said, man, yes, that's what Greg does every day. He, you know, he get off of work. Because I told the same gentleman, I said, well, I want to send a sweet sweep over. He said, man, you're crazy. You don't send that sweet sweeper, Greg will get mad. He get a broom and he sweep the sweet street. I mean, I said, what? He said, yeah, he sweep the street. Don't send a sweet sweeper here. Greg will get mad. Take care of that. And he was excited. He came and accepted his award that night at the city council. And I was glad to present it to him. And I hope the people that looked at it, and like you say, you may start doing it, or you're doing it, what have you. And, you know, it takes some people like Greg to do that. And when other people see it, they start thinking, you know, well, I can do that too.
Yeah.
You know,
well, you got signs when you're coming in into his area. Yeah. Love, don't litter.
Yeah, don't litter. And that's a good attitude to have. You take just that little one section he had, that when I say he had, that where he lived, that he's taken care of. And then if other people do the same thing and keeps going, you know, it's a chain reaction. People just start, hey, well, if they can do it, I can do it. And that's how things happen. If you paint your house, the next person paint their house, and then it should just keep going. You put flowers in your yard, you do something to beautify your area. Then if you do it, maybe the first week or two, they may not do it, but I guarantee you within a month later, they'll start saying, well, wow. Man, I want to do this too.
Yeah,
you know, and it just, and that's what I want. The neighbor, put it this way, let's take back our District 3. You know, certain areas, let's take it back. You know, and when I say take it back, let's make it look very inviting and beautiful where you want to live and have that quality of life and that hope you've been asking for. Let's bring it back.
Because
I remember years ago it won't happen again. Where you could go to at night, you didn't have to worry about it. Closing your wooden door. You had a screen door. You left it open.
Yeah.
And you didn't worry. Just to make sure the mosquitoes. That's the only thing you want to keep out of your house. The mosquitoes. Mosquitoes. And the flies.
Yes.
You didn't worry about somebody going inside your house.
Well, we got a lot of good men in the community.
Yeah.
I know this guy. I'm not going to call his name and not going to elaborate on it too much. But I know this guy. They got some elderly people in and around his house on Wednesday. He mowed their backyard.
Wow.
On Thursday, come and mowed all the front, you know? And they don't ask him, he don't ask for a dime for it.
Just
but, you know, he know that they can't do it as often as he do it.
Right.
So he just take it upon himself, man. And I think if
you live in District 3?
No.
Hey, man, whoever you are, come to District 3.
No, he live in another district.
Yeah, come to District 3.
You know, my lawnmower, I got a zero turn too, and I'm kind of afraid of it because I don't want to tear it up.
Yeah.
And when I first got it, man, it took me 3 days to engage the blade. him, you know, he know how to do it. And again, you know, Greg don't want a street sweeper in his area.
Right.
Because he do one block north, one block south,
yeah.
you know, one block west, and one block east. So And a lot of time the sweeper,
right,
you know, it picks up,
right,
but it leaves debris.
Yeah,
also.
Yeah, debris. And then what I have been doing is putting cameras in different areas in the neighborhoods. People have been calling, complaining about some they feel like illegal activities or people speeding, and they just want some cameras. So having to put a few cameras in different areas, and they have a few more that's gone up. And I tell you what, they are happy. For some of the people that didn't want them, they are happy, because sometimes somebody in the house happened to get burglarized or break into their car, and they got caught because of those cameras. And they said, well, you know what, I didn't want a camera, but now I want a camera. And again, a camera is not to spy on anybody. It just, it can help you. I mean, it's, again, if your house gets broken into, your car, or anything that happened that, again, that you may not want a camera, but it might help protect you or help you get your valuables back or catch the person that's doing something they shouldn't have been doing.
Yeah.
So it's not, again, not to spy on you. It's just to monitor your area to make sure your area is always well kept, safe, secure. Because everybody want to, you know, they want to have a place that they can live, enjoy, work, and be safe, and have their kids, their grandkids come and enjoy and have a nice community and a nice street to live on.
Well, you know, Councilman, when they first, you wasn't in office yet, but when they first start talking about cameras and people was hollering about them, that they didn't want them invading their privacy.
Right.
Put one on the post by my house. That way when I'm gone, I'm always home because somebody's watching my house.
Look
at all the things that happen with cameras, and if it wasn't for cameras, people wouldn't have got caught the way they have been getting caught. Right. If it wasn't for cameras, Mickey Shuney would still be out there. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of things that's happening in communities now, you know, people don't realize what cameras are there for. Mm-hmm. They're there to catch you. And some people, you see it on TV, especially on the news, they look right at the camera and say, oh, I'm busted.
Yeah.
Well, it's too late.
Yeah.
You shouldn't have been doing what you was doing,
right.
You know?
Well, you know, technology today you have, with all this new modern technology, you have cameras on your phone, and look how it helps when people are doing something they shouldn't be doing. I mean, every now and then you see people, for instance, I was looking at TV the other day with these motorcycle riders, and a guy got in his car, they beat him up, and I don't know who was wrong, who was right, but again, somebody taking a picture.
Picture, yeah.
You're hearing more things now because of the cameras. Before, we was in the dark.
Mm-hmm.
Things would happen 2-3 miles away from you. You didn't know anything until it was he say, she say. Now there's a camera that you can see it. Look all the things that have been happening in all these other cities and states, and you know, brutality that's happening, and because of the camera.
Mm-hmm.
That you know, now we can keep up with the news. Back then, you didn't know something would happen. It was a week or two later when you found out about it. Now, as soon as it happened, you know about it, you know, with the social media. So I'm not afraid of a camera, because if I want to do something wrong, I shouldn't do something wrong. So that's it. But if, you know, I try to live my life right and do the right thing, so I'm not worried. I'm not, but I know it's going to be there to protect me, the camera.
Right.
I remember about 5 years ago, I didn't have security in my house. I didn't have an alarm system.
Mm-hmm.
My wife and I were sleeping about 5 o'clock that morning. I woke up, normal wake up, and I realized how our house was burglarized. At night, they came in the house while we were sleeping. I guarantee that same day I had an alarm system.
Oh,
but
yeah.
But I lived where I lived at. I didn't think that everybody, I knew if somebody could come in, but it was only 5 houses. And the person that broke in, he went in everybody's house. He went in 2 of us, and the other 3 was trying to break in, but the people woke up and he ran away. But 2 of us, we were sleeping. He was a cat when he came in the house. I didn't hear anything.
He was
a cat burglar, yeah. And they caught him. But again, that's just to show you how, I mean, I was naive like everybody else. I don't need it.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't need it. But now I guarantee I wish. And how he was caught? By my cell phone. Because I figured they called that.
Tracking device,
yeah. My son-in-law was able to track him and then call the police officer, and they used his phone to track him. You know, with technology, you know, my son-in-law did have his phone connected to my phone connected to his phone. so he was able to track.
Technology is good right now.
Yeah.
I remember during the time I was driving 18-wheeler, and before I went into my own self company.
Right.
I had a GPS.
Really?
Yeah, I put a GPS.
They had GPS in the 40s, man.
No, it wasn't the 40s, man. It was just in the 90s. And the every time a trucker seen that GPS, oh, man, you ain't no trucker.
Oh, yeah.
You know, 2 years later, a couple of them got GPSs for Christmas.
Okay, Christmas.
Man, we should have followed you when you got your first GPS.
Oh,
you
know,
man, that thing saved gas, bro. Put you where you got to go on time.
I'm trying to figure out how people made it, man. How you knew where they were going without a GPS. Don't get me wrong. My wife and I would go on vacation. We didn't have a GPS, but she would look at the map. And I'm trying to figure out if you didn't have a map, you know, you just read the signs as you go.
Yeah,
you know? I know myself. I remember if I wanted to go to, say, for instance, I remember going to Corpus Christi, and I just say I knew what direction I had to go. So as I got closer, I started looking for the signs, you know. And then my wife would get out the map and say, "Well, you gotta go, man. That's the longest ride I ever been on."
Yeah, you remember Jeffrey Landry? They called him Bunny.
Yeah, the Black Mexican.
Bunny.
Yeah.
Black Mexican. Bunny. Bunny. Used to come with me. He used to be my navigator, and he used to read the map for me while I was driving.
Yeah.
But when I first started traveling, it was all about that atlas, bro.
Yeah,
you know. And I used to draw a line everywhere I was going on the map. Then my wife told me, she said, "You need to take this paper and pencil and write down all your directions, and that way you won't have to stop and look at the map." Man, when I started doing that, it started getting easy until I got almost to where I was going, and then I was lost because they didn't show you the name of the streets.
What about the people that didn't know how to read, man, and you know how they got where they were going? I mean, I guess they didn't go too far. You know, just if they were going, they didn't have interstate 10. I guess if they're going to Texas, they went on the whole 90, right? And they just knew, and I guess they would ask direction where they went.
Yeah,
stop and put gas. That's probably what, when they fuel up, they'd ask, well, you know, somebody, lucky they didn't send them on a wild goose chase.
Right, you know? And they did. Some of them did, you know, got you lost.
Yeah.
Some of them said, well, I'm going that way. Follow me.
Oh, you know? They did that too?
Yeah, they did that too, bro. I remember I was in San Antonio, Texas, and something happened to me and I got lost. And the guy said, "I'm getting ready to go that way. If you follow me, I'll put you right back on the highway."
Yeah.
"Thank you, sir." And that's the way we used to do it, bro.
You know? Yeah, and I can imagine that and you know how it was back then. But then again, I appreciate the time that you gave me, giving me to explain to my constituent where I have been and where I want to go. And again, I really would like them to know that I'm always visible and I can be reached. And I'll leave my number is 337-291-8803. Or if you're computer savvy, you can reach me at Patrick Lewis at Lafayette, LA. .gov. My name is Patrick Pat Lewis, and I am your District 3 representative. And whenever you need me, whatever your concerns are, you can always come out at the council meeting every first and third Tuesday of the month. We used to have 3 council meetings, now we drop it down to 2. And again, you won't be disappointed if you come, or you can look at it on television, AOL. You'll see they play it the same night, you know, so it's live.
You don't
have to worry about waiting. Then they play it again over again, so you don't have to worry about missing it because they will play again. I don't know when they replay it, but then if you call my office, they can tell you. If you don't see that Tuesday, they can let you know when they're going to replay it again, or we'll find out for it. I'm excited to be your representative. I do represent you in District 3. And if anything I can do for you, please don't hesitate and give a call. I gave you my number, my email address, if you're computer savvy, as I say. Or just come at the council meeting and or tell if your council person, you can tell your council person to call me if you need me to work with your council person for anything. Again, we all try to work together. It's not like one pulling against the other. We all in there together. Again, we consolidated, so we want to make sure that we all get what we are deserving getting. Again, I appreciate the time that you all.
I appreciate you coming in and being a part of Community Matters. I hope this is not your last time. Right. You're always welcome.
Appreciate that.
All you gotta do is get in touch with me. I haven't got big enough to have a secretary, but you have to get in touch with me, you know. And once you get in touch with me, yeah, I'll make sure that your agenda is on Community Matters.
I appreciate that again. Again, Pat Lewis. If you need me, I'm giving you all the information how to reach me.
Thank you.
And wish to see you guys again shortly. You'll be, if your neighborhood had not got what it deserved, call me, and I'll try to do my best to make sure that you, where you live, that you have what you want, that hope you deserve. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for everything that you're doing.
Thanks.